Yo, what's going on, fam, out there? It's your boy Tahir Johnson, and we're back with another episode of the Cannabis Diversity Report. Today, I have my good friend, one of my favorite, one of the best people in the cannabis industry, Susan Wang from Best Dispensaries. How you doing today?
I'm doing fantastic, Tahil. Thank you for the shout out. Thank you for inviting me today.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's all we always have. These good conversations. I always had to hold back before we got started live because, you know, I don't want to have all the good stuff that you have to say. Let the people hear it. But you know, you're out of Arizona. How's everything out there in Arizona right now?
Things are going great. Last Thursday, Best Dispensary, of course, with the authority given by Arizona Department of Health Services, we activated recreational sales of cannabis in Arizona. So we're serving now both medical marijuana patients and also adult use, which is recreational users. So it's been very busy, but very exciting, and look forward to breaking the stigma about cannabis and elevating its reputation through Best Dispensary, since we're the only luxury dispensary in Arizona offering an elevated and memorable shopping experience at our elegant store. So very excited about that.
Absolutely. And if everybody that's watching, like if you see Best Dispensary in the background, it really is beautiful. Like when I think of high class and luxury dispensaries, you know, that really is it. You did a great job with that, Susan. How'd you come up with the concept?
Thank you, Tahil, for recognition and again realizing that we are building a luxury dispensary. We're not talking about price here, but when we talk about luxury, the definition of it is a great state of comfort. So that's what I was focusing on. Of course, I didn't start out with the luxury dispensaries, right? All my other dispensaries when I first began in 2013. They were not like Best Dispensary. But throughout the years, that's what I've noticed, that there is a huge stigma about cannabis. And one way to break the stigma and elevating the reputation is by offering the people and the showing it. We can all talk about it, how effective cannabis is and how safe cannabis is. But if we don't give the ambience and if we don't make people the visual what we're talking about, it's hard to explain and justify. So that's why the inspiration came from that. Hey, we want to focus on quality, not quantity. And I rather build out a beautiful dispensary and have people to be in a safe and comfortable environment, and also very welcoming to where you can ask all the questions you want, because there are novice and also new users. So we need a space and an environment where we can effectively and comfortably talk to each other to figure out what we need to offer to our consumers. So this inspiration actually began because we wanted to break the stigma about cannabis, but also I wanted to create the comfortable environment for our customers.
Absolutely. And, you know, like again, I think that having that differentiation strategy is definitely what sets you apart for success. But you're a serial entrepreneur. Like you said, this isn't Best Dispensary isn't your only venture or cannabis business. Could you talk about some of the other things or some of the other brands or businesses that you're doing in cannabis as well?
Yeah, so Best Dispensary, just one aspect of it, but I'm the license holder and CEO of Jamestown. We're the only dispensary in Yuma, Arizona. And also under Jamestown, we have four cultivation site licenses, infusion kitchens where the edibles are manufactured, and extraction facilities where concentrates are prepared and where we distribute to other dispensaries too. So we have a 14 licensed facilities here in Arizona. And also I have Mama's Luxury Boutique, which is a luxury smoke shop. And also, just like the name Boutique, it's like a boutique where we sell customized and one of a kind and high-end bong. So we have Mama's Luxury Boutique and smoke shop next to all of our dispensaries. I also have a luxury CBD store called Daily Dose. Again, we're focused on our consumers and conversation and consultancy-based retail store for the CBD. So if you go to Daily Dose, it's almost like a Sephora store where you can try different CBD products, because trying CBD products are allowed, whereas we cannot allow you to try the cannabis products at Best Dispensary. So Daily Dose CBD Store is another of my business. And then we have other brands such as Bonnie and Clyde, which is good for the couples to use. And we have 11 other brands that we're going to be launching to here, recreational cannabis market in Arizona. So those are what I focus on far as businesses, but I do a lot of community work and focus on woman entrepreneurship and minority entrepreneurship as well. So I'm involved with Arizona Asian Chamber. I sit as a board member to focus on the economic development of Arizona through minority and Asian business owners. So I work with the various businesses such as like restaurants and boba shops and cafes and bakeries and printing companies and all these companies that are owned by and managed by minorities. I assist them with various business strategies to also helping them to secure funding and lending as well. And I am the board member and vice chair of Arizona Cannabis Chamber of Commerce. As you know, in the cannabis industry, it is still a new industry compared to others. So we definitely need to establish the standard. So because of that, I'm passionate about, you know, setting the rules and regulations, working with the government for the policy work and advocating for both consumers and the businesses and setting the bar high so that we can all be better, so that we can serve our consumers and the public in a better way.
Right.
And also, I'm the market leader of Woman Grow Phoenix in LA. So before COVID, we used to have a monthly in-person meeting, and usually 300, 400 people used to show up. And so I will have guest speakers. And I wish, you know, Tahil, you could have been a part of that. But right now we're going through COVID. But Woman Grow is a national organization where we focus on woman entrepreneurship. And also, you know, we're going to further talk about social equity and gender equity. But through Woman Grow, that's where I focus on elevating other businesses that are owned by minorities and women, especially in the cannabis space.
Right. And, you know, I love that you're, you know, that you're, it's not for you, it's not just about business. Like, you really are about like making sure that minorities and women have opportunities. And that's something that you've, you know, you've always been about. You know, talk a little bit about, you know, why that's important. And then, you know, some of the challenges that you feel like minorities and women can face in the industry or just in business in general.
Yeah, I love America. I love being a U.S. citizen. I'm so proud of it and I'm grateful. But I was actually born and raised in South Korea and moved to the U.S. when I was 12 years old. And I didn't even speak the language. And I remember the first day when I went to school, I didn't know the culture. I had no friends. I didn't know anyone. I didn't know the language. So it was a very challenging experience. So if you actually think about the cannabis industry and being a minority, especially a minority woman, it's actually that exact experience that I felt when I was 12 years old. So that's why I'm passionate about, you know, doing advocacy work and focusing on entrepreneurship within minorities and also the woman-owned businesses, is because it is challenging. It is that difficult. And it's not anyone's fault, but it's just the unfamiliarity, right? When people are not used to looking at female CEOs, when people are not used to seeing the owners and license holders that are minorities, you know, of course, the other parties, they are going to have a difficulty accepting or even taking you seriously. And again, like I said, stigma is there, but also stigma is what people build. And as you know, cannabis, the history of marijuana and how it was even illegal was because of what people did, right? Back in the days, in 1800s, marijuana was legal. And actually, even if you're a farmer in early colonies, you had to grow hemp and cannabis and use them to pay taxes to the government. And as you know, George Washington grew a lot of hemp and cannabis as well too. Well, so who made this illegal, right? It was early 1900s, and these businesses, you know, such as DuPont and cotton businesses, paper mill, William, you know, Hearst, media companies, when they realized that cannabis and hemp were competing with their own businesses, because hemp was much more effective than cotton and more efficient, right? And so because of that, they're the ones that utilize their power, political power and media, newspapers, magazines, and they started this campaign. And that's why they started to call this marijuana to specifically target African-American communities and minorities and Hispanic communities. Right. So they started to stereotype that marijuana is used by immigrants. Marijuana is used by lower socioeconomic groups. Marijuana is used by Hispanics and African-American communities. And that they continue to use that campaign to wrongfully lock up people. And just like how people are passing the cannabis rules and regulations in various states, it was a people who made it to be illegal to begin with. So again, that's why I'm passionate about, you know, focusing on this different organizations that highlight, you know, woman-owned, minority-owned businesses in the cannabis sector, because I know how difficult it is, but also the system is wrong to begin with.
Right. And, you know, it's definitely important for people to recognize that and acknowledge that history doing business in the industry, and to make sure that we're creating opportunities for those challenge groups. You know, that's why it's good to have good people and brands and businesses focused on that. You know, conscious capitalism, right, should just be a part of the business model. Susan, what brought you to the cannabis industry? What made you decide to, how'd you end up, you know, starting dispensaries and all those different things?
Yeah, so actually my degrees are in biochemistry and microbiology. I receive a Bachelor of Science in biochemistry from Arizona State University. Why did I study that? Because I was going to go into pharmaceutical industry. And then in 2009, when I heard about Prop 203, Arizona Medical Marijuana Act, that's when I developed my interest in the cannabis industry. Because I come from an immigrant family, again, I was taught that you don't violate any laws and rules and regulations. And, you know, back in those days, cannabis was, you know, not legalized in many states as we see now. So I didn't even have friends or people, didn't even know people who consume cannabis. I didn't even know what it looked like or smelled like. And then when I read about Prop 203, that's actually when I started to develop my interest. And because I'm a biochemist, what did I look at? The science of cannabis plants. And when I started to learn about endocannabinoid systems, you know, of our mammals, not just humans, but animals have endocannabinoid systems, and how humans have CB1 and CB2 receptors in our body to receive cannabinoids, which are the chemicals that are naturally present in cannabis plants. We do have receptors to receive these contents. So how can we say that it is not a safe way to medicate and help you to feel better and elevate and, you know, alleviate your symptoms and conditions that you're faced with? And also, when we have receptors within our body, CB1 and CB2 receptors, as a scientist, I had to question, what happens if our receptors are not occupied with cannabinoids because we don't consume cannabis? So then what does a deficiency of cannabinoids lead to, and how is that going to affect human body? So that's kind of where I developed my interest about the cannabis industry. But I was at the time, you know, working in the government contracting company, and that's where I started to learn about application process and government contract. So when Arizona Department of Health Services released the guidelines and the application process, that's when I started to look for the properties and got into the zoning, special use permit, conditional use permit for the cannabis businesses. And I helped other applications. I did my own applications. 10 years later, here I met, you know, license holder of multiple dispensaries, cultivation sites, extraction laboratories, and infusion kitchens. So how I got in was because I was going to go into pharmaceutical, but I changed the course. And now I'm still in pharmaceutical. It just is spelled differently. F-A-R-M, pharmaceutical, not P-H-A-R-M.
Nice, nice. And, you know, talking about the science a little bit more, since that is your background and specialty, also, you know, you haven't spent years owning a medical dispensary. You know, what would you say are some of the most common ailments or things that people use cannabis to treat? And, you know, what are some of, you know, what are some of the ways you see it helping people?
Yeah, based on my own observations since 2013, because that's where the first dispensary opened, I see a lot of patients with severe chronic pain and also cancer. So patients who are going through chemotherapy, they need support, right? And as we know, cannabis has cannabinoids that actually boost the appetite. So if you are going through chemotherapy or any treatment, as long as you eat well, pain-free, you rest, you have the energy and the health to comply with the regimen that the hospitals or doctors have. Because, you know, this chemotherapy to radiation can be very intense. So I see many cancer patients who actually take edibles or consume cannabis. The reason, you know, it's various of edibles or smoking flowers to vape is because we're not going to recommend lung cancer patients to smoke or vape, right? For patients with COPD. So that's why they utilize topicals, but also they like to enjoy edibles so they can eat and sleep and be pain management so that they can comply and they can cooperate with the radiation and chemotherapy that they're going through. But I would say most demographic we see is a severe chronic pain, and that varies too. So anyone from, you know, arthritis to osteoporosis, you know, issues with their bones and pain, a lot of sciatic, you know, nerve pains, and also lupus patients, we see a lot of them as well, even immune compromised patients, because you can use a CBD and THC and other cannabinoids in the cannabis plants to increase your own natural immune system. If your immune system is strong enough, actually your own body does have an ability to generate, like, such as T killer cells. So even in our body, as cells are being regenerated, the constant errors are happening. So then our body naturally does have ability to fight the cancers. However, when our immune system is compromised, that's when the cancer cells take over because we don't have enough white blood cells to defend or T killer cells to defend. So there are many, you know, additional medicinal benefits of using cannabis. But I would say we definitely see the most of cancer patients, HIV, AIDS, lupus, osteoporosis, arthritis, and severe chronic pain in general.
Right. And since you, as you said, you have a number of different licenses. Since you had the manufacturing license, you can manufacture cannabis products of different types, like you were mentioning. You had the cultivation licenses, so you can grow flower, and you have the dispensary, so you can sell cannabis. Can you talk a little bit about the cannabis supply chain, each of those different types of businesses, and why that vertical integration can be important to your business?
Yeah, so seed to sale, right? That's our tagline. And seed to sale is important because when you do not make good quality products, you know, that are safe and consistent for the consumers to consume, it's almost ineffective to consume cannabis. So you have to be really cautious. And this is what I want to stress. Not all flowers are made the same, right? Well, first of all, they all come from different genetics, but also different cultivation sites select different ways to cultivate cannabis. And also not how they cultivate, but how they actually maintain their facilities very important, because we do see, like, heavy metals, chemical additives or pesticides, you know, in various flowers. So again, that's why testing is important too. And also if you utilize flowers, let's say raw materials that are tainted or not passing the test, like for the pesticides or chemical additives, and you use them to make concentrates or edibles, now it doesn't matter what the kitchen or extraction facility conduct, because you're starting with the raw materials that are not quality. You cannot produce quality edibles or concentrates. So that's why vertical integration is very important to me, because again, best dispensary is not just all about luxury environment and elegant showroom, but we have to stand behind the safe, consistent, quality, third-party tested products. So because of that, vertical integration is very important. So again, cultivation sites is where, you know, flowers are grown. And then from there, they get transferred to the infusion kitchens and extraction laboratories. And kitchens make, you know, edibles such as brownies, gummies, hard candies, cookies, tinctures, sublingual honey sticks, bread strips, and also nano emulsified powders that are dissolvable, water soluble, which you can add to any food or drinks to concentrates are made at the extraction facilities, anywhere from the cartridges to oil, RSO, shatter, crumble, butter, live resin, diamond sauce, you name it. So again, that's why it is important for our company to be vertically integrated. But at our retail stores, we do sell other brands too. But I also am focused on the manufacturing and a vertical integration because it is my hope to bring other brands that are in other states outside of Arizona that are owned and operated by minorities and women. And I would like to introduce them to Arizona market under my licenses by doing a licensing agreement. So those are the scopes of the business structures that I have currently right now.
That is so dope. And you know, like you said, there's medical cannabis, and you touched on this a little bit earlier. Adult use was just legalized there in Arizona. What's it been like since you know, since that adult use legalization? You said that you just opened up for adult use. Was it last week or this week?
Yeah. So before, all my licensed facilities were medical only. However, last Thursday, not only we received the licenses for recreational, but state activated the program. So effectively last Thursday, all of our facilities converted to both medical and adult use. And our dispensaries are now serving patients and anyone age of 21 or older. So since then, it's been crazy. There are lines out the door. Our best dispensary, it's about 25,000 square foot building, and the line is wrapping around the dispensary. I told you earlier, Tahil, that I haven't served the customer and I haven't behind the POS station on the sales floor since 2014, 2015. And last Thursday, I actually had to assist our wellness advisors. We don't call our staff budtenders. These are wellness advisors, whether it's patient or adult, because even the people say that, hey, I just use it for recreational. And when you have conversation with them, you know, they are dealing with stress, depression, anxiety. And if you want to feel good, that means you are not feeling good to begin with. So even though it's recreational, I just look at it as a, you know, alternative medicine for all. So I was helping our wellness advisor, weighing out flowers, labeling, packaging. So it was a little bit different than my normal day-to-day operation, but it was a great experience because now I understand our own internal SOP, not just on paper, but by practicing it. So I've already been having meetings with our management teams and different departments to configure and, you know, apply the changes that I observe. And it was very refreshing to engage with the customers one-on-one as well. So it's very, very, very busy, and we're actually running out of supplies. So, you know, there is a shortage in inventory. So that's a challenge, but we're very blessed and we're very grateful. I'm looking forward to actually mainstreaming, you know, the cannabis and breaking the stigma by having the public to know about best dispensary. And I really look forward to changing the conception and misconception about cannabis users. Cannabis users are not lazy. Cannabis users are not poor. Cannabis users are not just minorities, but cannabis is just same as any other products that we enjoy. So we definitely need to spread the news and break the stigma together, because I do believe that cannabis is by far safer than alcohol. And also all those states who have legalized cannabis, they have seen 25% decrease in the opioid death. And so I'm looking forward to decreasing the number of opioid overdose by, you know, offering the cannabis to the public as well.
Absolutely. And you're 100% right. Like approval is times are changing. Approval, I believe, is almost at 70% of people that are approval of cannabis. And, you know, one thing that you had the perspective on as a member of the Arizona Cannabis Chamber, I know that you were active in lobbying and, you know, as being understanding the legislative processes these laws came about. You know, now there are a number of states that are considering legalization. They recognize the tax revenue. Cannabis was essential in every market where there was a legal cannabis business last year. You know, what type of advice do you have for, you know, people or businesses in new places like New York that want to see legalization get done? And actually, Arizona, I love it because you have social equity in your bill. How do they make sure that that happens when with legalization?
Yeah, thank you for bringing up that topic. Please contact me directly for more details. But long story short, for the Arizona, the Prop 207, it is actually smart and safe that passed. So I cannot take the credit. I wasn't, nor Arizona Cannabis Chamber was not the one that introduced a smart and safe Prop 207, which is a initiative that passed. Which we're allowed to sell the adult use cannabis. However, we introduced the alternative initiative called Small Business Liberty Act because under Prop 207, the license allocation is very limited because it is Prop 207 that allow the existing medical license holders to convert their facilities to dual, both recreational and medical. But Arizona statute, it only allows one license per 10 pharmacies. So there are a total 1,338 pharmacies. Last time I talked to the board of the pharmacy, therefore there are 133 licenses that are available. And I would say there are about 100 active license holders. So then that means there's only 33 roughly or around 30 that can be issued. So that's why social equity is very important. As you can tell, the market is very, very limited in Arizona. California, you see thousands of dispensaries. In Arizona, in Metro Phoenix area, I would say there's only less than 60 plus dispensaries. And there are some, areas like remote areas, like I talked about Yuma, there are a few dispensaries around. So there are not that many dispensaries available in Arizona. But again, because Arizona laws only allow one dispensary license per 10 pharmacies, unless the number of pharmacies go drastically up, you're not going to be able to see the new licenses that are being available. So business 101, supply and demand, right? When everybody wants something, but there's a shortage, what happens is a price increase. So that's why another option is to buy existing license holders out, like myself or other companies. But because we're doing so much, businesses, the prices are very high. So the license alone is, market rate going between 4 to 6 million. And then there's a real estate that you have to secure, and there are inventory, there are, employees, there are assets and equipments that you have to secure. So, you're looking at like multi-millions, like double digit to start cannabis business in Arizona. But that's why social equity is important. Through social equity, there may be 26 licenses that will be allocated, but no one knows what the requirement of a social equity is yet. Arizona Department of Health Services has to further define that. So, again, if you have questions about social equity or licensing, you can go to Arizona Department of Health Services website. It is actually azdhs.gov, and you can go to adult use cannabis section for that. But again, social equity is what we're interested in. NCIA and Tahil and I talked about it multiple times through Arizona Cannabis Chamber of Commerce, and we really advocated for, social equity. But again, it's up to the state how they want to define who is qualified as a social equity applicant. And another caveat is convert our fundable application fee per license. And then also for the new licenses, we have to provide a $500,000 liquid asset, not in your stock portfolio or in your real estate properties, but your liquid asset, we have to prepare that per application. So it is a very expensive, you know, application procedures, but we don't know if they're going to require that for the social equity, right? We don't even know the definition of it yet, but we don't know what the requirements for the application is going to be far as a financial backing. So we're all holding our breath and observing. But like I said, check the website daily and feel free to reach out to me. Feel free to reach out to Arizona Cannabis Chamber of Commerce, and we can provide you with the insights that we have. But it is ultimately up to the state.
Absolutely. And I know the bill and everything's not out. Like you said, it's not, the rules aren't done yet. But, you know, what advice would you give if somebody is a, you know, if somebody is like, you know, a social equity, potential social equity applicant, what do you think are some things they should start doing now to prepare and kind of get ready for exploring opportunities in the industry?
Yeah, so if you're preparing for social equity, you definitely need funding. Not because application fee or the requirement is going to be $500,000 or six figures, but once you have your license, you have to start the business, right? So that's why, regardless of what the application procedures or requirement is, you will still need to secure the money for, you know, the real estate place, and also to start the business and to take care of your, you know, legal matters, right? You have to have your attorneys. I cannot, you know, stress that anymore. If you don't have money, go borrow money, but still always have an attorney to protect you. And also social equity, you have to do your due diligence, because don't just partner up. There are predatory, you know, partnership that people are looking for. There are hostage takeover. There are various, you know, stories that I heard. So if you are the social equity qualifying applicant, understand who's going to be your partner. And don't just partner because, you know, they have abilities or talents, but look at their characters and also what can they provide. And also, are they just providing money, or are they also going to be working? And then what are you providing? So it's for you to, you know, really sit down with the group of people or with the individual, your potential partners. But I think securing that is very important. Another thing that's important is, where are you going to apply? So knowing your local ordinances. It's not just about the state licenses. Let's say state gives you a license, but if the local jurisdiction do not allow you to operate, then your license is no good. And if you do not open your license within 18 months, even through the social equity, the state might potentially seize your license. So what good is a license if you get issued, but you never activate it and you never build it out and you never open and in time, and then they take it away? Now, you know, that was a waste of time and money and energy for everyone. So know where you're going to be at, and then be familiar with the local laws, the city ordinance or the county ordinances. And after that, what's also important is the properties. You cannot just do cannabis business in any spaces, but there are stipulations and distance requirements that are included in the local ordinance. So make sure you identify what commercial properties are available and also how much they are. And if you have abilities, you know, get into the contract to secure them. But if you don't, then you need to start talking to the property owners or the lease option and, you know, various alternative solutions. So I think those top three are, you know, the main concern. Of course, business plans and all of that is important too. But why would you write business plans if you don't have specific, you know, plans for partnership or real estate properties? And also, without having specific geological location, like where you're going to do your business, it's hard to establish business plans because you don't know your target market, right? Depending on the zip code, depending on the cities, your business plans and your strategy and your marketing strategy and your standard operating procedures and your SOP and your policies and procedures will all vary. So I think business plans comes after securing the funding and zoning and real estate place. And then, you know, you work on the business plans.
Right. And, you know, you've been in the game now. You've built a successful business and a successful brand. You know, here at NCI, we have our social equity scholarship program. We have over 100 social equity operators and applicants that are in our program, getting education, resources, and everything with NCIA. You know, for somebody who might be a newer operator, what's some advice that you wish you knew a few years back when you were just starting out, you know, that you would share or, you know, give to somebody who is an operator or licensee, you know, that is trying to figure it out?
If you are fairly a new operator, new license holder, please educate yourself about IRS code 280E. I wish I understood about, you know, taxes and 280E, how IRS look at the state license facilities, even though we're legal in the state wise because of, you know, the Arizona Medical Marijuana Act and Smart and Safe Adult Use Cannabis Prop 207. Federally, they still look at all of our dispensaries and licenses and cultivations and facilities touching cannabis and marijuana considered as illegal per federal rules and regulations. So we pay a lot of taxes to IRS, and IRS actually is doing a lot of financial audits on cannabis, you know, dispensaries, grows, kitchens, and labs. So you have to really educate yourself about 280E. Long story short, what 280 is about is that cannabis businesses touching cannabis cannot write off anything except for cost of goods sold. So typically, cannabis industry pays 65 to 75% more taxes than any other industry. If you are running a restaurant, you can write off your mortgage, insurance, your rent, and your utilities, including payroll. However, in the cannabis industry, unless it is directly associated with the cost of goods sold, so meaning dispensary employees, our employees like who are selling the marijuana to or cannabis to the consumers, their payrolls, we cannot deduct that. That's not a tax write-off. We have to pay tax on that. And the reason that being is they're not manufacturing. So I would definitely highly encourage you to be familiar with 280E. It's like 280 alphabet, like E as Edward. And then I look up the IRS code and have a competent accountants and CPAs. Bookkeeping is really challenging for cannabis industry because a lot of it is a cash transactions. So document and have receipts, have more documents. So when IRS asks you for the source documents, you have to prove it. Even though it's true, if you cannot prove it, IRS is going to make you pay tax on that expense. You know, so make sure you're very organized and structured when it comes to bookkeeping, accounting, tax reporting, and also compliance is really important, right? Without the licenses and compliance, following the rules and regulations, you will not have your business. So don't try to cut corners and compromise a compliance and, you know, rules and regulations. Always do what's right. Don't dabble into gray areas, but, you know, strictly adhere to the compliance and local rules and the state rules and, you know, whatever the department that's issuing the licenses to you. Have good relationship and follow their rules. Since they're the ones that wrote and adopted the rules and enforcing the rules, it's not up to you to define. However, having good attorneys behind you is really effective too. So don't just enter into contracts. Don't just commit. Always have the attorneys to do their due diligence so they can protect you and your business and that you understand what you're signing and what you're committing to. And then lastly, what I want to say is that growing is very important, right? Growing your business and capital is very important, but not all money, not all capital, not all investment is good money. Sometimes by partnering up or taking that investors, what are you giving up? So really understand, you know, don't just borrow money and then promise people, you know, equity or partnership. If you do, then great. Then define it, you know, through the attorney, really understand what their rights are and what your rights are and what you're giving up. Because I've seen many, many, many occasions where, you know, a lot of different lawsuits and partnership disputes, you know, that are arising from that. And, you know, many see social equity applicants or social equity license holders later getting kicked out because they didn't have financials, but also they gave up all of their management or decision-making control to the other party because they put out the money. So I would say accountants, attorneys, rules and regulations, and understanding and following the laws are the most important.
That is great advice right there. I hope you all are listening out there. Susan, what are some other cool things, anything cool coming up with Best Dispensary or anything new we should be looking out for?
Yes, I'm very excited to share that next door to Best Dispensary, we're also going to do an expansion. So not only we're going to be the luxury dispensary, but I want us to be known as the largest dispensary in Arizona. So I think right now it's Planet 13. They claim to be the largest dispensary in the world. And so Best Dispensary, you know, we hope to actually beat that. And so not only luxury and elegant, but focusing on the, you know, capacity too, so we can better serve our customers. Another thing that we're very excited about is the launching of our wellness center next door. So it's actually going to be accessed by our customers and our team members too. Best Dispensary's motto is to cultivate good times. So not only through, you know, cultivating good products and producing good products and selling good products, but we want to cultivate good times, meaning we want to make people feel good. So the next door, the wellness center, will have a yoga room, Pilates studio, and also co-working spaces, a massage room where, you know, you can consume CBD, and we utilize a CBD rub to massage you. And also there's going to be a luxury smoke shop and Mama's Luxury Bong Tea and CBD store called Daily Dose. So what's unique about that is that if you are the customers of Best Dispensary, we keep your portfolio and we track your purchase and give you rewards points. And you can use these rewards points next door at the wellness center. So you don't have to spend money, but you use our points to experience all these extra massage, you know, personal grooming and meditation, yoga, Pilates, and CBD and smoke shop inventory. So that's what we're excited about.
That is super dope. And I know it's probably almost opening time. And I, like you said, it's a busy day, so I'll let you get back to it. Can you tell everybody where they can find and follow you and where they can find and follow Best Dispensary?
Yes, thank you for having me today. And Tahil, you always do an amazing job highlighting other people. So I definitely want to give you a shout out. Thank you for your consideration. For me, I'm very active on social media. On LinkedIn, you can find me under Susan Huang, SusanHwang. And also at Best Dispensary. So is Instagram. I post daily and I do my own personal posting. So you're engaging me directly if you reach out to me on Instagram. I am under Susan Huang, SusanHwang. And Best Dispensary is, of course, the name itself, Best Dispensary, BestDispensary. PenSary. And I recently joined Clubhouse. So I love talking. I love sharing information. So if you're on Clubhouse, look for me. I'm under Best Dispensary, BestDispensary.
Oh my gosh. And speaking of Clubhouse, I know you sent me the Clubhouse invite. I need to get an iPhone so I can get on there, man. Everybody's been telling me I need to get on Clubhouse. Has it been dope? Has it been fun?
Very great experience because it's audio only. So it's almost like a live broadcasting of multiple conversations all over the world and different sector. I'm actually in real estate too. So Clubhouse, you know, it's been really nice to talk about multifamily unit, construction, real estate development, wholesale parts of real estate. And also, you know, cannabis industry presence in Clubhouse is very strong. So, you know, there's an IP attorney, Sheila Gibson. She's my IP attorney, and there's zoning attorneys. There are different city officials that are on, you know, Clubhouse too. So like I said, I cannot speak about it anymore. But in the beginning, I used to spend about 3 hours on Clubhouse because, you know, you can just put on your earpiece. And as you're working on something else, you know, you listen to other people's conversation. And so it's so educational. But also you can raise your hand to speak or ask questions. And it's a great source of tool to network with other people. So yeah, I've been enjoying Clubhouse a lot and I cannot wait to see you there, Tahil. I know you'll be sharing some jams and amazing stories with many people thousands of people in the clubhouse.
Absolutely. You'll see me on there. And Susan, you know, I want to say thank you. This right here actually is the 30th episode of the show I've been doing. So we've been doing it for a while. Big thank you to you, all my friends that have been coming through doing this for me. Like, it's been dope, well received by everybody. Definitely looking forward to just keeping doing dope stuff. So thank you for coming through. Number 30, that's big.
Thank you, Tahil. I feel so honored that I got to be on your 30th. Congratulations and many, many, many more accomplishments through, you know, this platform. And you're doing an amazing job for other people in the community. So again, share the knowledge and share the wealth. It's not about what you know, but it's about who you know. So again, thank you for this opportunity. And for all of you out there, like I said, I'm very active on social media and I love networking and I'm an extrovert. I get energy by communicating with other people. So don't hesitate to reach out. Reach out to Best Dispensary. Reach out to me as Susan Huang. Thank you.
Absolutely. Have a good day, Susan. I'll talk to you soon.
Thank you. We'll be cultivating good times. Bye, guys.
Bye.